A very good morning to everyone. Welcome you all for the third technical session of day 3. Today's technical session is on the topic nutrition during early childhood. So let me introduce to you our today's resource person, Professor G. Saraswati. Ma'am has completed her Bachelor of Science degree in Home Science, securing first rank from the University of Mysore in the year 1967. She has completed 2 master's degree, one in child development, securing first rank in the year 1969, and second one in foods and nutrition in the year 1971, both from Madras University. Her PhD was completed in foods and nutrition at Mysore University CFTRI in the year 1982. Ma'am has an experience of 17 years as a professor, 20 years as a reader and lecturer. She has served for a total of 37 and a half years from January 1982 to June 2008 in the Department of Studies in Food Science and Nutrition, University of Mysore, Mysore. Coming to ma'am's publications, including co-authors, she has published 8 books, 7 in Kannada and 1 in English language. Out of which she has received awards for 2 books, and 1 book was invited from Karnataka State Open University in the year 2010. She has published a total of 7 booklets and folders and 10 pamphlets, both in Kannada and English languages. 10 package of lessons she has published in Karnataka Open University and National Open School, Delhi. 70 research articles were published by ma'am, including international publications. 20 popular articles were published in Kannada language. She has done compilation of lectures in 2 workshops. Now talking about her research activities, Professor G. Saraswati has completed 10 research projects, 7 as principal investigator, in which 2 were invited by UNICEF, 1 from Association of Food Scientists and Technologists, and 2 from Defense Food Research Laboratory, and 3 projects as a co-investigator. Ma'am has guided 12 PhD students, 130 MSc dissertations, 100 research paper presentations by her students in national and international conferences. She has participated in more than 100 national and 5 international seminars and symposiums. She was invited for delivering more than 100 lectures from various academic bodies, including in rural areas. Ma'am has served as chairperson of the department for 3 terms of 2 years each and organized several workshops, conferences and exhibitions. She even served as the chairperson of Board of Syllabus for 3 terms in Food Science and Nutrition and Human Development. Now let's talk about the awards and prizes received by ma'am. She has received 2 gold medals for securing first rank in BSc. She was awarded ICAR Fellowship to pursue MSc based on All India Competition. She was awarded SRF CSIR to pursue PhD in Central Food Technological Research Institute. She received 2 prizes for writing books in Kannada, received 6 prizes for poster presentation in conferences. She was awarded Best Home Scientist for the year 1999 and received Vasundhara Memorial Award in the year 2003. Other activities of ma'am are she served as a subject expert for various institutions like CFTRI, Research Council, National Open School Ministry of Education, Delhi, UGC Research Committee, Delhi, National Institute of Public Cooperation and Development, Department of Women and Child Development, Government of Karnataka. She served as a member of Board of Appointments, Board of Studies, Board of Examiners, and served as an adjudicator for PhD thesis for various universities. She served as a referee for research articles for publication in journals. She even served as a member of Faculty of Science, Academic Council, and Syndicate Member IQAC at University of Mysore. Ma'am has been involved in several activities even after retirement from 2008. Let's glance those activities. She has served as a visiting professor to Pondicherry University for 2 semesters in 2009 and occasionally gave lectures as and when requested. She served as an expert member of Working Group 2 FSSAI, that is the Food Safety and Standards Authority of India, Government of India, New Delhi. She has served as a member of Committee for Development of Science in School, University of Mysore from 2006 to 2015. She served and still serving as an expert or consultant in the field of nutrition for Akshaya Patra. Since 2008, ma'am is serving as a consultant for outreach programs of health and nutrition education of school children in around schools of Mysore, organized by Nestle India. On request, she delivers lectures as part of education programs for women and children for voluntary agencies like Vijnana Parishad for school children, All India Radio at Mysore Station, associations of women and other voluntary agencies. On request, she even writes articles on health and nutrition in Kannada language. This is the brief introduction of our today's resource person who will be talking on the nutrition during early childhood.
Good morning, one and all. Let's start our today's session on physiology during early childhood, that is from 3 to 8 years. Along with children growing taller, maturing also involves growth in their ability to perform, skills to think, to trust or have confidence in themselves as they get older. So, understanding normal growth and development is essential to establish a complete and effective nursing care plan for children. Now, let's see what is development. It is the term which means all the physical and psychological changes a human being undergoes in a lifetime, that is from the moment of conception until death, and the changes are swift and impressive. Child begins to understand and speak a language, engages more in complex thinking, displays a distinct personality, and develops the skills to interact with other people as a part of social network. Between the birth and to the age 3, a child typically doubles in height and quadruples in weight. Apart from this, it also masters in many skills like sitting and walking, toilet training, maintaining coordination, etc. Between 3 to 5 years of age, children continue to grow rapidly and begin to develop fine motor skills. And by age 5, most of the children demonstrate fairly good control of pencils, crayons, scissors, etc. and gross motor skills like ability to skip and balancing on one foot. We see that physical growth slows down between 5 and 8 years of age, while body proportions and motor skills become more refined. First 3 years of life, children develop to speak vocabulary words between 300 and 1000 words and use languages to learn and describe the world around them. By the age of 5, they speak vocabulary up to 1500 words, able to produce 5 to 7 word sentences and tell familiar stories using pictures. From 3 to 5 years, growth in socio-emotional skills includes formation of peer relationships, gender identification, develop a sense of right and wrong. Like example, at the age of 5, a child may expect others to share their possessions freely, but still they will be extremely possessive of their favorite toy. And between 5 and 8, children enter into broader peer context and endure friendships. Now, coming to the domains of child development, it has got 4 domains. Cognitive domain, which includes learning, imagination, critical thinking, problem solving, reasoning, and memory. Physical domain comprises motor skills, that is fine and gross motor skills, hand-eye coordination and balancing. Language, that is communication with others, learning and interpreting sounds, talking, vocabulary, written language skills. And fourth, socio-emotional domain, that includes getting along with others, play, social relationships, self-esteem, understanding and expressing emotions. Now, let's see the physical development among the early childhood. By 3 to 4 years, child starts to walk backwards, climbs stairs, rides a tricycle, turns pages of book, holds crayon to write steadily, unbuttons and buttons up clothing. By 4 to 5 years, the child hops on one foot, walks along a line, starts to use a knife and a fork. 5 to 6 years, they start to jump, skip, hop using both feet, confidently uses a knife and fork, steadily holds a pencil. By 6 to 7 years, child rides a bicycle, jumps confidently, runs with coordination, has fully developed hand-eye coordination, draws complex shapes, writes their full name, writes short stories. And by 7 to 8 years, children hop on both legs, runs in a straight line, cuts using a pair of scissors. Cognitive development. So, according to Pager's theory of cognitive development, there are 4 stages. That is, first stage, sensory motor from birth to 18 months, where the child learns through senses, reflexes, and manipulate materials. Second stage, pre-operational stage, that is seen from 18 months to 6 years, where child form ideas based on their perceptions, overgeneralize based on limited experience. Third stage, 6 to 12 years, concrete operational stage, where the child form ideas based on reasoning, limit their thinking to objects and familiar events. Fourth stage, formal operations, from 12 years and older, where the individual think conceptually and hypothetically. Language development. Language skills is divided into receptive skills pertaining to listening, reading, and productive skill, which includes speaking, writing. So, by 3 to 4 months, we see the child cooing for the first time. 6 to 9 months, the child babbles. 15 months, they use gesture. 18 months, they start mimicking and use 20 words by 18 months and around 50 words by 24 months. And in 24 to 36 months, they use the word no and vocabulary increases to 300 words. By 4 years, the child starts to describe what they have done that day. By 5 years, they recite story, understands basic instructions. Socio-emotional development. It includes the child's experience, expression, and management of emotions and ability to establish positive and rewarding relationships with others. Developing mind and social experiences produces remarkable advance in self-development, emotional maturity, moral understanding, and gender awareness. Also, ability to communicate, connect with others, resolve conflicts, display kindness, and cope with challenges, which are crucial for school readiness. So, without cognitive, social, and emotional self-control in the classroom, learning cannot occur. Now, let's see the developmental milestones. By 3 years old, child gains about 4 to 5 pounds, grows about 2 to 3 inches, reaches about half of his or her adult height, and has improved balance and vision. He got all 20 primary teeth, may have bladder and bowel control in daytime and nighttime as well, can pedal a cycle, often ask questions, can dress self, has longer attention span, knows own name, age and gender, that is boy or girl. They start to share developmental milestones by 4 to 5 years. They gain approximately 3 inches, hops, swings, climbs, shows more independence, brushes teeth, cares for own toileting needs. 5 to 6 years, jumping, skipping, hopping is more controlled, gains approximately 2.5 inches, enjoys playing with same aged peers, toileting accidents usually end. And by 6 to 8 years, physical growth slows down, body proportions and motor skills become more refined. They are able to think the situation. Increased competency is seen. Understanding the rules, compares self to others, develops a sense of what is fair. They begin to build more confidence in academic skills like reading, writing, and become more independent. Let's see physiological aspect of growth and development in children. Nature and nurture contribute to the growth and development of children. So, nature or heredity are biological influences on physical development, whereas nurture or environment, that includes diet, disease, and socio-emotional circumstances, has a role on physical growth and development of a child. Genetic factors. A person's height is likely to be closely related to his or her mother and father. Late maturing adolescent often shares late maturity with other family members. Genes regulate physical development by neural and hormonal activity in different organs and body systems. Neural factors. Brain includes a growth center that monitors and compares actual rates and levels of growth of individual. An increase in growth rate often occurs if some environmental factor interferes with normal increase in height during infancy or childhood. Hormonal factors. Hormones that are produced by cells in hypothalamus, which is present in the brain, has a growth center that triggers or inhibits production of human growth hormone. It encourages production of somatomedins, which is a specialized hormones manufactured by many other cells in the body that directly regulate cell division for growth. Socio-emotional factors. Early studies showed immense disruption in physical growth if a warm, consistent caregiver was unavailable to the infant. Label of failure to thrive was attached to these children. So, when there is no specific genetic, biological, or medical basis identified for growth retardation, it is labeled as non-organic failure to thrive syndrome. So, in this session, we saw the four domains: physical, cognitive, language, and socio-emotional development with milestones and physiological aspect of growth and development in childhood. So with this, I'll conclude my session. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Josephine. Now I request Professor G. Saraswati to talk on nutrition during early childhood.
Greeting from Mysore. I'm Saraswati, retired professor, Department of Food Science and Nutrition, University of Mysore. I am very happy to share my views on preschool children, especially with reference to nutritional needs and problems, especially concentrating on 3 to 6 years. One of the incredible events in the nature is how an infant grows and develop into an adult. As you all know, food intake is one of the basic factors necessary for growth and development of the child. Nutrients present in foods are the fundamental elements necessary for growth and development of children. Early childhood is one of the significant stages in our life cycle. Children from infancy to adolescence are in the fast track of growth and development. And early childhood extends from 3 to 6 years, and our life expectancy of Indians is 70 years. Consumption of nourishing foods during childhood is vital for all-round development of children. This in turn ensures healthy future for the child, family, community, and the nation. I want to recall your memory with regard to the major nutrients which are present in our foods and what are their functions. As you all know, I have just listed here carbohydrates, lipids, protein, minerals, vitamins, vitamin D, vitamin B group, vitamin C, and water. In addition to that, I have included one substance, phytochemicals. They are non-nutrients, but they are very good health protectors. And these are abundant in only plant foods. And another thing which you have to remember is 5 food groups. With the help of this, we can select a balanced diet. As you know, the cereals and millets, largest quantity in our plate is cereals and millets, vegetables and fruits, milk and milk products, pulses, oil, seeds and flesh foods, oil, sugar and jaggery. These 5 food groups are very important, and we can see that cereals and major contribution is towards starch and protein because of the bulk of the diet. Vegetables and fruits, calcium and iron. In addition to that, some vitamins. They help in bone and teeth formation, vision and growth, and so on. Milk and milk products are very good. Proteins are given for vegetarian, especially bodybuilding function. Pulses also give large quantity of proteins, bodybuilding and protection. Oil, sugar, they are mainly energy givers. Now, will deliberate certain issues related to nutritional needs of preschool children. And Dietary Guidelines of ICMR is a very good reference book for nutritionists as well as non-nutritionists. The fast-growing children need well-formulated balanced diets for their optimum growth and to boost immunity. Especially now in this corona season, I think immunity plays an important role, as you all know. The most striking changes in preschool children are nutritional needs of preschool children. Children need more energy-giving nutrients, carbohydrates and fat, body-building proteins for their growth and development. They also need calcium, iron for growth of the bone and development of hemoglobin in blood. Therefore, energy and body-building foods like cereals, pulses, milk, egg, oil and ghee are necessary for them. Protective foods like vegetables and fruit provide minerals, vitamins. They also help to develop immunity and protect the children. In order to obtain a balanced diet, dietary allowances in terms of nutrients and foods are suggested by ICMR, specifically for preschool children in addition to all other age groups. Here the table gives the recommended dietary allowances for macro and micronutrients, and they are necessary per day. You can see energy, which is derived from protein, fat and carbohydrates. Calcium and iron are the major minerals which we require. Vitamin A in the form of retinol or beta carotene are also given. Thiamine, riboflavin, niacin, which help in energy metabolism. Then dietary folates are necessary for hemoglobin formation. So these are necessary per day. How to get this? Balanced diet for preschool children is recommended. Cereals, millets, pulses, milk and milk products, roots and tubers, greens, other vegetables, fruits, sugar, fats and oils. Now here we have divided into 1 to 3 years, 4 to 6 years, because the 1 to 3 years are fast growing children compared to 4 to 6. But the recommendation of nutrients and corresponding foods will be slightly different for these age groups. The requirement is given here in terms of grams, but in the book, guidelines book, they have given in terms of portion size of foods per day. However, this may be a little bit difficult for the common man to understand. Therefore, the nutritionist should help in giving the measures in terms of cup, teaspoon and tablespoon. Another important thing that you have to remember is 5 food groups, which will give balanced diet. This is a very easy way of explaining to a common man. For example, this is the cereal group, cereal, and the second one is vegetables and fruits, dairy products, meat and fish and pulses, oil, fat, sugar. So these are the 5 food groups. At least you have to select one food from each food group and select all these and then consume per day. Then definitely you will have balanced diet. In addition to this ICMR recommendation with regard to nutrients and other things, there are little things which you have to remember as parents and concerned with the children. Number one is frequency of feeding or snack should be increased to take care of the bulk of the consumption of foods and nutrients to fulfill their growth and development needs. If a child falls sick, for example, fever and so on, the child loses appetite, simple food should be given with a lot of fluids. The child recovers from disease, feed the child with concentrated energy and protein sources of foods to recover fast. If the child develops vomiting and diarrhea, feed the child with oral rehydration solution or boiled water with little salt and sugar or rice congee to replenish water in the body. This liquid food should be fed to the child before taking the child to a medical doctor. Do not show any likes and dislikes with regard to foods in front of children, because they also will learn bad habits. Now, you may be curious to know whether our young children are getting a balanced diet and are they healthy or do they have any health problems like this. Unfortunately, the answer is a big no and a small yes, based on the reports of surveys conducted by NNMB, NFHS and Department of Women and Child Development and so on. It's also unfortunate to know that only 14.4% of 6 to 23 months of children are consuming adequate diet. It is really unfortunate, but that is a fact. Now, what are the major nutritional health disorders in preschool children? You can see anemia, underweight, stunting, and these problems can co-occur also. For example, the child with underweight can have anemia. A stunted child may have anemia like this. And these, if they are not taken care, they will be shifted to school age children. Now, how to find out the nutritional health disorders or undernutrition in children? Accepted methods are anthropometric measurements, heights and weights are taken into consideration, and WHO classify them as normal, underweight, stunted and wasting. And even adults are also classified based on body mass index. Another important method is biochemical method. Anemia is usually diagnosed with the help of a laboratory test. Dietary survey and clinical assessment tests are also used by community workers. Now, impact of undernutrition on height and weight of the children as graphically represented by WHO. You can see that the normal child with normal height and weight. Normal height, but it is thinner than normal. Stunted child and shorter than normal. Wasted and stunted, thinner and shorter than normal. It's very easy to understand. If the child is undernourished, it will affect the height and weight of the children. But if you go to a Anganwadi or preschool child, you can see that all these three children from Nanjangud village, you can say that they were all playing together happily. And if you ask anyone to say, for example, guess the age of these three children, the first one will easily, they'll say 3, 4, 5, like this. You won't believe that's what the answers were. But in reality, all of them were 6 years. Just imagine this child, shortest child, is 3 years before. Just imagine the shortest child is considered as 3 years, is 3 years behind, 3 years behind this, the normal child. Shortness will continue, this shortness will continue in adulthood, and this may pose many problems. Anthropometric indices used to classify nutrition status of preschool children. There are three important indices: weight for age, height for age, and weight for height. This first one, weight for age, it helps to identify underweight or overweight. This classification is widely used for ICDS beneficiaries. But of late now, even the overweight in urban areas is becoming more and more. Height for age, this helps to measure stunting. It's an index of cumulative past energy and protein deficit. Stunting is a permanent insult to physical development of the child. That's why it's considered as very important problem of preschool children. Weight for height, this helps to measure wasting. And it is considered as an index of short duration of undernutrition. Diseases like diarrhea, respiratory infection, fever and measles can lead to a sudden weight loss and wasting can occur. Now, WHO has given the classification of anthropometric indices to find out whether the child is normal or stunted, severe, using Z-score and standard deviations. You need not worry about how it is derived and all, but you can use the ready-made tables to classify children. This is one example of the chart which is given, growth standards, WHO growth standards. WHO growth standards, they have given based on standard deviation classification. This one example is weight for age. Those who have worked in this field would have seen these charts, but I just wanted to show you how it looks like. For example, age is given in terms of months, and this side 1SD, that is, this is normal. Starting from 2SD, they are all, undernourished. And girls also similarly, they have different standards are there for boys and girls separately. Now, coming to the data on undernutrition as given by NFHS for Karnataka, I have taken and given the chart with figures. Weight for age, it's around 36.2, and height for age, 36.2, is quite considerable percentage of children are undernourished. And I've shown the data of Vijayapura just to compare with the Karnataka figures. It's really unfortunate to see that there are slightly more percentage of children suffer from underweight and stunted children. So perhaps something has to be done for the preschool children of Vijayapura by the concerned authorities. Now, another important problem is anemia. This occurs due to deficiency of iron in the diet and results in low level of hemoglobin in the blood. Anemia is defined with respect to an individual as a state in which the hemoglobin concentration has fallen below WHO standards. You don't worry about this statistical thing. It is only a statistical construct, and this ready-made tables are used for diagnosing purpose. So HB can be assessed easily by a simple method, and it can be compared with the WHO chart and say whether the child is suffering from anemia or not. Now, coming to the data, NFHS data reported that 60.9% of 6 to 59 month old children were anemic in Karnataka, whereas in Vijayapura, 68% of the children were suffering from anemia. Now, why should you bother so much about this anemia? Because the consequences of anemia are quite dangerous for development of children. What happens? We'll see. Red blood cells profile changes. Size and number of the cells decrease, resulting in lowering of hemoglobin content in the blood. Hemoglobin helps in oxygen transportation, and therefore when the level of hemoglobin goes down, naturally the oxygen carrying capacity will also decrease, and thus suboptimal biochemical functions are observed. These biochemical changes result in children to have a very pale look, induced fatigue, no enthusiasm in anything, any learning, any activity. Thus functional changes occur. These problems actually they debilitate healthy development of children. Now, what are these performances which are affected by anemia? Work output, work capacity are impaired due to anemia. Moderate and severe forms of anemia result in reduced endurance. Individuals taking a longer time to complete tasks or activities, for example, running race, daily physical activities are conducted with longer period of time by anemic children. Immunocompetence is reduced, therefore they get frequent infection and other things. Mental and psychomotor functions, poor attention seeking, poor memory and academic performance. So the bulk of the research studies suggest that iron therapy to these anemic preschool children showed significant improvement in cognitive performance, motor development, and ability to acquire language and school attendance. On the whole, children were happy after getting iron tablets. Thus, these nutritional health problems, namely stunting, wasting, and anemia, are addressed by the National Nutrition Mission, which is a Government of India's flagship program to improve nutritional outcomes for children, pregnant, and lactating women. Now, the government of Karnataka has implemented various programs under the umbrella of National Nutrition Mission to improve health and nutritional status of preschool children, especially with reference to stunting, wasting, anemia, and all-round development. Anganwadi is a hub of activity center to provide nourishing food for physical development, medical care, health and nutrition education, and so on. In addition, iron and vitamin tablets are also distributed to children to combat anemia. Nutrition education on appropriate and adequate foods for children during illness and wellness of children is essential, and they are carried out. Now, preschool children, with reference to some points on COVID-19, a pandemic disease. Preschool children and early persons are prone to infections, especially COVID-19. They have less ability to fight against infection because of low immunity level compared to young adults. It is well known by now that elderly persons with comorbid conditions like diabetes, high blood pressure, respiratory problems like bronchitis and others increase the problem of COVID-19. An interesting note on this situation is that the preschool children who are underweight and stunted may also suffer from anemia. Children who are anemic have less oxygen supply in the body and low level of resistance to infection may precipitate the problem of COVID-19 in children. Another important message is that iron and vitamin A deficiencies in children are well known to reduce resistance to infection. Thus, children with nutritional problems suffer from low immunity status and they are prone to any type of infections, including COVID-19. In addition to this, right now, COVID-19 cannot be cured with medicines. Therefore, it is essential to keep them away from infection. In addition to sanitization, social distancing, preschool children have to be fed with nourishing foods, provide psychosocial needs and other paternal care to give admirable atmosphere suitable for health and wellness. Now, can we, the adults of today, look forward for a strong nation with healthy children of today? As you all know, National Nutrition Week is one modest program to sensitize all those concerned with the healthy development of children. Usually, a special theme is selected to celebrate National Nutrition Week in the month of September every year. This year also, the theme is notified by the Department of Women and Child Development. Various activities in relation to the theme are carried out. Prime Minister of India has launched Poshan Abhiyan with a vision to make India malnutrition free by 2022. The objective of Poshan Abhiyan is to reduce stunting in identified districts of India by roping in Anganwadi workers and other health workers. As you all know, India is a developing country with a lot of nutritional problems in children. However, these problems are further precipitated by pandemic problem of COVID-19. Special efforts are necessary from the government, individual, family levels. Let us hope for positive developments in the field of nutritional needs of preschool children, which may elevate their health and nutritional status. It's really a challenge for all of us to provide a good future of children. Wish you all an excellent and useful National Nutrition Week. We should pledge to help in spreading the message of consuming the right and adequate foods for nourishing children to focus on their bright future. Can we dream one day in future at least, you know, when all children are happy and expressed like this? This Akshaya, 3.5-year-old boy, is telling, I'm healthy, I play well, I am active in school, eat and sleep well. Thank you, Mama and Papa. Why he's thanking is because this child is getting healthy food, nourishing food, milk and milk products, along with cereals, pulses and others every day. What else you expect from a child? Lastly, I want to thank all the authorities and staff of this university for giving me an opportunity to share my views with all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Josephine, for explaining us the physiology during early childhood. And thank you, Professor G. Saraswati, for your talk on nutrition during early childhood. It was a very useful and informative session, ma'am. Thank you once again from the Department of Food Processing and Nutrition, Karnataka State, Akka Mahadevi Women's University, and on my personal behalf, I thank you once again, ma'am. This is the end of today's technical session. Thank you, dear participants, for listening to us patiently. Once again, I would like to tell you that e-certificates will be issued to those who fill up quiz and feedback forms every day, which will be provided in the Telegram group. And all the PPTs of the technical sessions will be sent to all the registered participants to their registered email IDs. Thank you, one and all. Have a great day ahead.